Well, thank you, Russell, for your welcome. It's a pleasure to be here with you again this evening to worship God. That's the reason we're here tonight, isn't it? To worship our great God, to give him our praise and our thanksgiving. And I've chosen a hymn which is special to me in the sense that I knew the writer. I say I knew because he's singing it now in much better ways than we are, because he died of a brain tumour some 25 years ago, but I was with, if you look at the hymn 23 and at the bottom who wrote it, Michael Perry, we were students together at Oak Hill College many, many years ago. So we're going to sing that lovely hymn to begin with, number 23. O God, beyond all praising, we worship you today and sing the love amazing that songs cannot repay. Number 23. Evening to you in prayer with the free access given to us by our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that he said, if you ask anything in my name, then it will be given you, to his disciples. And we come tonight in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We dare not come in any other name, because there is none other name given under heaven whereby we must be saved, except that lovely name of Jesus. Jesus, Jehovah saves, the Saviour of the world. No one can come to you, to Almighty God, except through him, because he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And so we thank you, Lord, for this free access we have into your presence and to you, Almighty God, alone. And we praise you for this immense privilege that you, in your grace, you have stooped down to touch us as the human race. You could have ignored us because of our rejection of your ways, because of our first parents, Adam and Eve, rejecting your express command not to touch the tree of good and evil. But Lord, you had mercy on them, and we thank you that you have mercy on any sinner who comes and pleads the faith of Jesus Christ and says, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. And so we come tonight, Lord, thanking you that you forgive our sins when we confess them and when we repent. We pray your blessing on the service tonight. Speak to us from your word. Bless us. We need your blessing, Lord. And we pray, speak to us each and every one. Help us to worship you as you are worthy. We pray for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to read from the Old Testament first, and it's the book of Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come upon me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? So he said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, Indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, Thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am, has sent me to you. This is the word of the Lord. We're going to sing the second hymn. It's number 422, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. This has been translated into many different languages, very popular hymn. 422.
We should never be discouraged.
turn again to the Word of God, this time to the New Testament, to the second letter of Peter, to Peter. To Peter and chapter 1, and beginning at verse 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Saviour Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. For this reason I will not be negligent to remind you always of these things, though you know and are established in the present truth. Yes, I think it is right, as long as I am in this tent, to stir you up by reminding you, knowing that shortly I must put off my tent, just as our Lord Jesus Christ showed me. Moreover, I will be careful to ensure that you always have a reminder of these things after my decease. For we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honour and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And we heard this voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. May God bless this reading of his holy word. We're going to turn now to God in prayer. We come to you, our Lord God, our Heavenly Father, thanking you for our access, as we have already done tonight, and thanking you that you hear the prayer of all those who come to you in and through the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for the spread of this wonderful gospel throughout our land tonight. May it be preached faithfully in many pulpits, and where it's not faithfully preached, we pray provide men who will preach it faithfully. And Lord, we long for a time of revival, as you have sent on our land in the past. You've sent men who have preached the gospel, unknown men, until they came and you anointed them with your Spirit, and they preached the gospel and led many, many people to yourself. And we pray that will be the case tonight, as your word is preached here in our country and elsewhere in Europe, and later in America and Canada and South America. May there be a great harvest of souls truly repenting of their sin, truly understanding the message of the gospel and truly responding in faith. May many be saved today and enter your kingdom. We pray your blessing on the ministry of Jim at Guy's prison tomorrow, as he has a conference call there, this Bible study. We pray bless it, and we pray that there will be prisoners who will turn to Christ and believe on him. And we pray too, Father, for your healing for each member of this church who is in need of, who is in pain, who is in need of healing. And we pray particularly to heal Margaret completely now that she's home again. We pray for, Lord, for the beach missions run by Open Air Mission and United Beach Missions. We pray, give great wisdom to Professor Steve Taylor and to Tim Howlett as they lead the work. And we pray, Lord, that the gospel will be shared with many thousands of children and adults. We commit to you the time we had just recently in Bournemouth, reaching out to the people in the square in Bournemouth. We pray there'll be those who will turn from their sins. It's those who've never heard the gospel before. We think of Arabs, many Arabs over the years, who've, hundreds of them, who've heard the gospel, who have received a gospel of Luke in Arabic. And we pray there'll be many of them who will turn to Christ. And Lord, we pray for the people of Afghanistan, thinking of their attitude and thinking of their fears at this time. We think of the words of our Lord Jesus describing the last times when he said that men's hearts failing them for fear. And we see that in the pictures on television, the people handing their babies over to the soldiers simply that their babies might be kept safe. And Lord, we know that there are Christians there. There have been missionaries there too. People, men and women of immense courage, obeying you and going there to share the gospel. We know that some have been brought out. We pray that all of them will be kept safe, whether brought out or staying there. And Father, we pray, you know each and every one of your children, and we pray, watch over them. Keep them from harm, from danger. Keep them from giving in to pressure from the Taliban. And we pray, we dare to pray even, that many of the Taliban will be saved, that they'll see the attitude of Christians and the love that Christians show to each other. And we pray that you'll open the eyes of many Taliban to believe on our Lord Jesus Christ and to be saved. And we pray, Lord, for the work of this church. Bless the elders of this church. Give them great wisdom as they lead it. And Father, we pray that the church here in Clink will be like a lighthouse, leading men and women and young people, boys and girls, to the light of the world. Jesus, who said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. So, Lord, we thank you that we can bring these needs to you in prayer. And again, we pray, bless us as shortly we turn to your word. Speak to us from it, we pray. Fill us with all the wonderful things you have done. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we turn to God's word, we're going to sing. It's number 582, a lovely hymn. In full and glad surrender, I give myself to thee, thine utterly and only and evermore to be. 582.
I'm
to turn again to our second reading, which is the second letter of Peter and chapter 1. Second letter of Peter, chapter 1, and I'm going to reread the first four verses. 2 Peter, chapter 1, verse 1. Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Saviour Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. It's Peter writing. Peter, one of Jesus' 12 apostles. Peter, known for his faith, said by some to be the first pope, but of course that is far, far, far from the truth. And he is Peter who, after making that marvelous, wonderful confession, when Jesus said, "Who do people say that I am?" Some say you are Elijah, some say that one of the prophets. And then he turned the question on his disciples, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter came out with that wonderful statement, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said, "It wasn't you who thought this up, it was my Father in heaven who revealed this to you." And that's a reminder to us, isn't it, that when we're speaking to people about the gospel, as Jim will be tomorrow, as you do in different places in Froome and elsewhere, we need the Holy Spirit's enabling. We can be very clever, we can explain the gospel perfectly, but we need to pray that God the Holy Spirit will take it and use it so that people will understand the gospel and believe on Jesus. And so it's Peter writing. Peter, who on one occasion rebuked the Lord Jesus. That's a terrible thing, but that's what he did. But here is Peter who has repented, he's turned from his sins, and he's now explaining the gospel in this letter that he's writing to the church. And as we read the scriptures, I hope day by day for everyone here, we come across things in the Bible which are utterly amazing. Things that not just belonging to a religion, far from it, but things which are beyond the thoughts of human beings. Amazing things, that God should love a fallen world. Isn't that an amazing thing? You won't find that in the Quran. It says there that God loves those who love him. The Bible says God loves those who are sinners. That God should love a fallen world, that is an amazing statement we find in Scripture. That the Son of God should become man, this mighty Christ, founder of the world, flinging his, as one of the modern hymns says, flinging his stars into space. He should become man, and I'm reminded of that lovely hymn by Charles Wesley, if I can get it right. Let earth and heaven combine, angels and men agree to sing with songs divine the incarnate deity, thank you, Russell, the incarnate deity, our God contracted to a span, incomprehensibly made man. Doesn't it stagger you? This morning I was preaching for Bill Goodman in Bethel Church, in Baptist Church in Bath, and there was one of the members of the church who gave birth just a few days ago. And there she had this tiny, tiny little girl in her hands, just a few days old. And it was amazing to see this. But the Son of God willingly became man, willingly became subject to all the limitations of a human being in order that he might have, the writer to the Colossians and the writer to the Hebrews says, he had to have a body, he had to become a human being, because if he was going to suffer on the cross, then he had to be a human being to die. And that's why he became man, in order to die on the cross, in order to die in our place, that we might go free and forgiven and have eternal life. Another amazing thing in Scripture, that Jesus should should die for sinners like us. And then another amazing statement, that the Holy Spirit lives in us. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he says, it's chapter 6, sorry, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, he says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you? That means to say that God lives in each and every Christian by his Spirit. That's an amazing statement. I can't explain that. No man can. But that is what Scripture teaches. And so we have this list of amazing things that we find in Scripture. And we have another one in this passage, verse 4. By which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And the statement is this, that you may be partakers of the divine nature. We as Christians, it's good to remind ourselves, who are we? Well, we're told in verse 1, like Peter, Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ. And it may seem puzzling to some people that Jesus said, I call, speaking to his disciples who believed in him, he says, I don't call you servants or slaves, because a servant doesn't know what his master is doing. I call you my friends. That's why we sang that hymn just now. What a friend we have in Jesus. And it's good to remind ourselves that who are Christians? We are servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. So how can that be if Jesus says, you are my friends and not my servants? And then Peter says, and we agree with him, we are servants of our Lord Jesus. And why is that? You find the answer back in the Old Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, that when a Hebrew was tied by contract to another Hebrew, then he was free to go after, I think, 7 years. But he didn't have to go. He could go and have his freedom and then go away as a completely free man. But he could choose to stay with his master. And what the master did when he found out that his servant loved him and liked him, was to take an awl and push it through his ear into the door, the jamb of the door, and that in that way the servant is saying, I want to belong to you forever. And so Peter says, I am a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ. I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. We have received a precious faith, as precious as that of the apostles. That's why Peter says a little later in this chapter that I saw him. We saw him on the mountain. He's speaking of that passage in Scripture when Jesus took Peter, James and John with him and went up a mountain. And there they met Moses and Elijah. What an amazing occurrence that must have been, to meet these two great saints from the Old Testament, Moses representing the law and Elijah representing the prophets. And it's as if they're attesting, yes, he is the Messiah. And Peter, James and John just look on amazed. And that's why Peter says, I saw him. And a little later, John says in his first letter, he says, that which our hands have handled, which our eyes have seen and our hands have touched, he's speaking of the man Jesus. He says, him we declare unto you. And this same God gives us his grace and his peace in abundance. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Does it amaze you that when God gives something, he gives it in abundance? And so we read in John chapter 10, that lovely picture of Jesus as the shepherd, the good shepherd. He says, I am come that they may have life and have it how? Have it more abundantly. So by knowing God and Jesus our Lord, nothing, that's a simply an amazing fact. Knowing God is the very pinnacle of man's possible achievement. Oh, I know that climbing Mount Everest is the highest point in the world. And I was amazed to read a few years ago that there was one woman who not only climbed Everest, but climbed it twice in 1 week. That's an amazing thing to happen. And you think, well, what is the very top of a man's achievement in this life? Well, to become a professor at Oxford or Cambridge, well, they're amazing achievements. But what about becoming the champion of mastermind? We watch this sometimes, and it's amazing the knowledge that some people have. But I remember hearing once, turning on the radio, and it was a service, it was a woman who was leading the service, it could have been a man. And then as she prayed this prayer, to the God, we pray to the God who is unknowable. And that's an amazing thing. What's the point of praying if he's unknowable? Because that's not Christian teaching, far from it. Even if many people believe it, it is not Christian teaching. Did you know that in the Quran it speaks of God being so great, which he is, of course, but so great that no one can know him, that it's a blasphemy to say that man can know God, that he is far too great. But listen to the words of the Master, to the words of Jesus in John chapter 17, which was a passage that Jesus prayed, knowing that he was going to be crucified the next morning, knowing he was going to be betrayed by Judas and abandoned by all his disciples during the night. And this is what Jesus says in his prayer to his Father in John 17, verse 3. He says, "This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." This is eternal life. Eternal life, I remember hearing this when I was a youngster, when I was a teenager. And I used to think, eternal life? Is it just a repetition of what we live through day by day? I wasn't converted then, and life seemed boring to me in those days. And I thought, if that's eternal life, I don't want it. Ah, but I was completely mistaken, because Jesus gives a definition of eternal life. He says, "This is eternal life, that they may know you," that is God the Father, "and the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." And Paul, later writing to the Philippians, says this. He knows his life on earth is gradually drawing to a close. And he says, speaking of Christ in his life, he says, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death." We read in verse 3, "As his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue." We see how wonderfully God has provided for us, in that everything that we need to live a Christian life has been given to us. That we can't add to the work of Jesus, that we don't need another book, another holy book like the Book of Mormon, or the Quran, or the erroneous translations of the Jehovah's Witnesses. We met Jim, Bill Goodman and I led an open air just over a week ago in Bath, and a lady came along accompanied by another lady, and she started speaking to us, and she says, "I'm a Bible student," and we shared the gospel with her. She said, "I agree with everything you've said," and then she said, "I'm a Jehovah's Witness." And Bill said, "You don't agree with all that we say, and because you say that Jesus is not truly the Son of God." "Oh, I do believe that." And so off she went. And just a short time after, a man came along and said, "Well, I'd like to see what you're preaching." And we shared the gospel with him. And he said, "I'm a Jehovah's Witness." And he agreed with all we said. And again, we said, "But you don't, as Jehovah's Witnesses, you don't agree with all these things." So we don't need the Quran, and we don't need the Jehovah's Witnesses Bible. God, it says, will provide for all our needs through his generosity in Christ Jesus. And with the provision that God gives us, we can live a life of godliness, a life pleasing to God, through knowing our great God in faith in Jesus Christ, the God who called us by his own glory and goodness. He does this through his divine power, says Peter. And this power has the same origin in the word in Greek as dynamite. It's power. It's the mighty power of God. And then he goes on to say in verse 4, "His power by which we have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Through these things, the provision that God has made for us, a wonderful Bible, that's our word of God today. God speaks to us through his word. And he's given us very great and precious promises. What are the promises of God? Well, they're very, very many. Many promises in Scripture. They're not like human promises, many kept but many broken. The service engineer says, I'll be out by 1 o'clock to fix your stove or whatever it is, and he doesn't come, and late, many hours later, he comes and he hasn't kept his word. So what are God's promises? There are too many to number. I'm told that I haven't counted them myself, but I'm told there are over 3,000 promises that God makes in Scripture. Just listen to some of them. God says to Moses, to his people through Moses, he says, I will be your God and you will be my people. That's an amazing statement. That you belong, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you belong to God and you are part of the people of God. And then when you're tempted to guilt and reminded by the devil of your sins, the things that you are ashamed of, God says through the prophet Isaiah, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Don't you find that astounding, amazing? I rejoice to read that verse. It's absolutely wonderful. And then he says, I will build my church. They're the words of the Lord Jesus. I will build my church after Peter's confession. I will build my church. It's hard going evangelism these days. It's hard going in our country and other countries of Europe and in America. But there are countries in the world, even Muslim countries, where the gospel is spreading fast today. Today, it's reckoned 100,000 believers in Algeria. And when we were there as missionaries, they were numbered in hundreds. Today, 100,000. They say that the church is growing rapidly in Iran today, in fulfillment of the promise of Jesus, I will build my church. And then, don't let your hearts be troubled when things get on top of us and life becomes too difficult. Because Jesus says, you believe in God, believe also in me. And what about the lovely words of Jesus from John chapter 11? When you see a hearse drive up to the church building and you see the coffin being carried in, and the words, the wonderful words of Jesus, I am the resurrection and the life. How much comfort that is given to people over all the years. And then, well, there are so many of them. Then we look at Romans chapter 8, a verse that absolutely thrills me. Therefore, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And Jesus, in Hebrews chapter 13, makes a promise. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. What a wonderful promise that is. And he says, I will give you another comforter. Jesus, as man, could be in only one place at a time, but the Holy Spirit is with his people, each and every one, at all times. So these are God's treasures, able to preserve us in an evil world. God's promises can be counted on totally, 100%. It's like building a house on the rock so we can build on God's certain promises. So we shouldn't say, I'm too weak to lead the Christian life. We shouldn't say, my problems are too great for me, for God to expect me to live a Christian life all the time. No, because we have great and precious promises to look to hold on to, that will keep us going. Because it is in God's divine power, his dynamite, if you like, because that's the meaning of the word, that makes us strong. So we're called upon to meditate on these promises. And when you find life is too difficult, then meditate on one of these great promises of God. And you will find the problems gradually diminishing in importance. Think of them when the going is hard. Turn them over in your mind. And particularly when you've fallen into sin, remind yourself of that lovely promise, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, God is faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Claim these promises of God when you're in an impossible situation, because God has given these promises to us to remind us to look to him and to draw on his strength. And so Peter says that we have escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. The corruption in the world, evil desires, corrupt practices, evil living. We are surrounded by it all the time. It's intensifying and it's awful, and standing out from the crowd is not easy, but the promises of God strengthen us that we may keep on going. But particularly, and I want to concentrate on this now, that we may participate in the divine nature. That we may be participants in the divine nature. It's a verse that puzzled me for a long time. It fascinated me. What does it mean that we may be participants of the divine nature, or you may be partakers of the divine nature? What does it mean? And I have wrestled to understand this particular phrase, and it's so deep, so profound, no one can fully understand it. Some commentaries just dismiss it, just a verse in the Bible, but it's a gold mine. It comes from the same root as fellowship in Greek, and it means to have a share in, or to participate in, or to take part in something with someone, to be partaker with someone of the divine nature. But this someone is not just anyone, it is none other than Almighty God himself. And this someone is not just anyone, it is Almighty God. We're sharing with Almighty God. Now it doesn't mean, to begin with, it doesn't mean that we will become like God. Far from it. That was the temptation of the devil to Eve. When Adam and Eve were told not to touch of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they could touch all the other trees and eat from them, but they were to leave that one alone. The devil, listen how the devil, the serpent, speaks. Now the serpent was more cunning than the beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. But he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die." And then this is it. "For God knows," this is the devil speaking, "for God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Like God. That's the temptation of the devil. And when God works in someone's life, we will never become like God in that sense. Not like the Roman emperors. That was the big problem facing the Christians in the days of the early church. Dominated by the Roman Empire, the emperor demanding that people worship him, treated as a god. And what? Because there were many Christians who refused to accept this. Many of them were thrown to the wild beasts, and many of them were put to the sword. Not like King Herod. We read in Acts chapter 12 that one of the King Herods, in Acts chapter 12 verse 21, we read, "On a set day Herod, as arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration to them. And the people kept shouting, 'The voice of a god and not of a man.' Then immediately an angel of the Lord struck him, because he did not give glory to God." Not like the president of North Korea who wants to be worshipped. We can never become divine in that sense. That is for God Almighty, for Jehovah himself alone. So if men go to one extreme and call themselves God, there are others who go to the other extreme and say that man is just an animal. A man is like an ape or a chimpanzee or a monkey, because like them, man breathes and eats and drinks and sleeps and reproduces. There was a book that came out in 1967, written by a man called Desmond Morris, who went to school in West Lavington, and it was highly acclaimed. It was totally atheistic, and the message of his book was this, that man is just an animal. True, a highly developed animal, and there are some good qualities in animals, and there are even cases of what we call altruism, when you do good to someone else, not expecting anything in return, that even cases of altruism, even in animals. And I remember hearing a story which I found wonderful, that in the Yellowstone Park in America, there are fires that happen frequently, and the old vegetation is burned away, and the animals flee to other parts of the park. And there had been a fire in the park, and a little group of wardens were walking through the park to note the damage after the fire had died down. And then one of them noticed something very strange. There at the base of a tree, there was a bird that had been burned in the fire, which was dead. But there was this bird at the bottom of the tree. And one of the wardens touched it with his stick, and the bird fell over, it was just a shell, and out ran three little chicks from under the bird. And they knew why it was like that, because the bird could easily have flown away in the fire, but the mother bird knew that her chicks couldn't fly, and she sheltered them there under her wings and gave her life to protect her little ones. Or what about the case I've read about of dogs being very closely linked to their master or mistress, and when they die, they go and sit at the graveside day after day in memory of them. But man is in a totally different class. Animals may be beautiful, they may be awesome, they may be magnificent, and I often, when I cross the bridge in Chippenham, some of you know it, I often look at the swans, the graceful swans swimming along the Avon. Or you look at a horse, look at the advert for Lloyds Bank and this horse, one of my wife's favourite adverts on TV, to see this lovely horse galloping along, or to see an eagle soaring up in the mountains. Once we had an invitation from French friends of ours in Algeria to take us to a mountain range called Les Warsanis, and they took us right up to the way up on the mountainside, and there was absolutely silent, absolutely still. And we watched the eagles just soaring round and round in the skies above us. But man is far, far higher. Man, said Scripture, is made in the image of God. And Jesus Christ graced the human body by himself becoming a man. And so Scripture says it clearly, we're made in the image of God. We are partaking of the divine nature. Man, after his fall from grace, chapter 3 of the Bible, of the book of Genesis, he became, sin entered the world and death came through sin. And yet through the ruins of human nature, we can still detect traces of glory. The great J.C. Ryle, who was the first bishop of Liverpool and a thoroughly evangelical Christian and bishop, wrote a book called Holiness, and in it he says that to look at the ruins of Babylon or Greece or Rome, it's true they've fallen down, but you can imagine what they must have been like beforehand. And sometimes when I used to do deputation in the north of England, I would call by in Fountains Abbey, this great building. The roof has fallen in many years ago, there's no wood left, all the glass has gone from the windows. But you can see what a magnificent building it must have been at one time. And so in the ruins, says Bishop Ryle, in the ruins of humanity, you can see traces of God's glory. And how do we see that? Well, take a man or a woman who spends their life caring for somebody else, for a husband, for a wife. What about two German Mennonite missionaries a long time ago, who heard of a slave colony in the Caribbean and wanted to go there and evangelize these slaves. But they found out that no one could go into the colony. It was for the slaves only. So what did they do? They became slaves themselves in order to share the gospel with the other slaves. What about the intelligence that God has given man to send a man to the moon When I look at the moon at night, I think, how on earth did they manage to send a man to the moon? Think of the courage in war, a man dying, his moans and his cries in pain coming from no man's land. And one of the soldiers gets out and climbs over the parapet and goes to him in great danger of being shot and rescues a wounded soldier. We think of the beautiful art that man can inspire. And I went to the National Gallery and I looked in amazement at Turner's painting, The Fighting Temeraire, of this warship coming back to be broken up. And then going to look at the very picture of Constable's Heywayne. Art and music and literature, all these wonderful things. It's man made in the image of God who creates them. It's man seeking after God. There are men and women all through the world who are seeking after God. And I'm reminded of the words of Job in the midst of all his suffering, when he cried out in his pain and his misery, he cried out, "Oh, that I knew where I might find him." And this is what man is doing, looking after God. So what must man have been like before he fell into sin, when he was created perfect and sinless? What will man be like one day when there will be no more sin and when all believers will be glorified in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ? Man is the very pinnacle, the very peak of God's creation. A partaker of the divine nature? Yes, see how it is expressed. The Son of God calls his disciples his brothers. Isn't that an amazing thing for God the Son to call human beings, believers in him, his brothers? He calls us his friends, as I've quoted already. I call you no longer servants, but friends, because a servant does not know what his master does. Romans, the epistle to the Romans, says that we are children of God by adoption. Children of God? Isn't that amazing? That God dwells in believers. 1 John chapter 4, verse 12 shows us. 1 John chapter 4, verse 12. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. God dwells in us. The Holy Spirit lives in each Christian. And wonderfully, that lovely passage in 1 John chapter 3, we shall be like Christ. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, for we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. It doesn't say we're going to become gods, far from it. We will never become all-knowing like God is, or all-powerful. But we will be like him in holiness and in righteousness and in love and living forever. Listen to what Paul has to say in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. So why in verse 4 of 2 Peter chapter 1, where it says, which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through them you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust? Why does God make it possible for us in this way? He says, in order to escape the corruption of the world. We have corruption all around us, all the time. And God wants to preserve us, not resigning from the world, we can't do that, but preserving us in the midst of corruption. The Lord has made us new people in Christ, no longer living for our sinful nature, but now living, seeking to live according to the Spirit of God within us. We are partakers of the divine nature. Can you think of anything remotely resembling this statement in Scripture that describes us? So says Peter, live according to your high calling in verses 5 to 11, but also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble, for so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, there is no higher calling than that, to be partakers of the divine nature. And even when you get home, you were to receive a call from Buckingham Palace inviting you to become a member of the royal family, it would be nothing compared with partakers of the divine nature. As the hymn puts it so well, changed from glory into glory, till in heaven we take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and praise. And that's our hymn to end on tonight. It is number 653, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. 653.
Love Divine, all loves excelling.
Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Saviour, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.